Man, Sinister is one of those films where it seems no one can really make up their mind when it fits in the horror echelon. Scientists allegedly produced a study to find the scariest movie ever made, and this was the winner. Yet reviews would suggest it's nothing special. I find horror fans can be hot or cold on it, and the general public really rate it. Do I smell Marmite? It follows a true crime writer who finds some old Super 8 tapes in his home, and discovers that they all link to a case he's currently working on, potentially discovering a serial killer who's been on the run for decades. The case grows more and more intense as he finds out this isn't your typical murderer. It's a very quiet and low-tempo film, not like many others at the time. I won't spoil what the killer's motive is, but it's pretty sadistic and dark, creating a vile villain for us to chase who's bathed in secrecy. It's a genuinely intriguing mystery, and a lot of the entertainment you'll derive from it is trying to figure out just what's going on with Ethan Hawke. He may not be a detective, but the way his writing mind works makes him driven to reach a goal and uncover this morbid secret. And I had a ton of fun going on the journey with him. He's also rather smart. These are all film reels that he finds, so naturally they degrade or are easily flammable. What does he do? Whips out his video camera and films them to keep a digital copy that he can manipulate on his computer. I didn't even think of that. This makes it a horror where modern technological advancements are actually taken advantage of quite a lot, which is weirdly uncommon. The film is shockingly gorgeous. When I was thinking back on Sinister, the colour that came to mind the most was jet black. Half the time, there's barely any other colour on screen besides pale accents of just barely illuminated skin. There's no greys or midtones, just darkness and light. It's like Begotten if it really was filmed today rather than The Birth of Christ. The soundtrack is also stunning. It's very bassy and guttural when building a mystery, then when we're watching these tapes, it becomes strange and acoustic sounding melodies. It really reminded me of Silent Hill. Those tracks that sound laid back but have a creeping sense of dread and danger to them. There's vocals that you can't really understand and repeat off key. It's a spectacular use of audio to create fear.
You shut up! I'm so fucking scared right now, you shut up!
These Super 8 filmed murder reels are the highlight of the film. They're so visceral and raw, and the fact they're devoid of sound just adds to the realism of the scene. It's all shot as though these are legit snuff films. The frame rate's a little off pace, the camera jumps around all handheld, and the effects in these scenes are really damn good. It truly got under my skin. Then there's the other side of the film, where its 2012 release really shows its colours. This is where the film's atmosphere and intrigue just get thrown to the side in favour of jump scares that have little to no relevance. Like his son having a night terror and jumping out of a box. There's just no need for it besides keeping ADD modern audiences from turning away from the screen. Because God forbid they encounter a mainstream horror movie focused on intriguing plotting and atmosphere. There's build up to fake outs, things popping out and going roar but not really being that scary, you know the drill. The film is 1 hour and 50 minutes long. Honestly, I think it would have been far stronger if they cut out all the jumps and just left it as a slow-burning mystery. For example, there's an elongated scene where Ethan goes up to the attic and finds a snake that gives us a jump scare. He finds a new clue, then immediately falls through the ceiling for another jump. Why was the snake necessary? The further we get into the film, the darker and more intriguing it does get, but the more these derivative elements raise their head too. And don't get me wrong, I am not opposed to jump scares. There's actually a couple in Sinister that are amazingly well done. But when it's cliched and unoriginal offerings that really don't add anything to the proceedings, that's where my take is, there's no reason. The movie's ending even appears like it's going to go out on this lingering dark note, but can't help itself and ends in a cheap jump.
Did I jump scare you?
You shut up!
Sinister is a darkly stylish horror film with a ton of fantastic unique elements, but frustratingly has more cheap, modern horror aspects shoved into it unnecessarily. In my opinion though, the good stuff far outweighs the bad, and it truly lives up to its name. It's one sinister movie.
This one's mine.
The film was a hit, and so a sequel was released 3 years later, with the deputy from the first film returning and a new family finding the tapes. And now I'm gonna have to get into spoiler territory. After we have already learned who is making these tapes and why, children being influenced by Bagul to kill their families, I was interested to see where they take the concept. Bagul has promised to make it as a classic movie monster. He's got a cool look and an appropriately dark style, but I couldn't see how else he could be explored. Turns out, the film goes for a different approach, showing the children's side, and how they are recruited by Bagul and eventually convinced to kill their family. The problem is, it's not very interesting, and a lot of the movie boils down to just watching children talk to one another or seeing them jump scare people in poorly executed sequences. If you took the worst elements I discussed with Sinister and cranked them up to 11, this is what Sinister 2 equates to. And it's not like it was rushed out either, they had 3 years to work on it. Not even the death tapes are good in this one. Gone is the creepy realism and carefully selected camera work to heighten the horror. Here, we get a child climbing a tree over a river and hanging adults upside down on a branch to feed to a giant crocodile. It's so over the top silly, how'd a kid even do that? Here, it's also filmed on 16mm, which removes that old-style grain and framing that Super 8 had. However, the soundtrack, while nowhere near as memorable as the first movie, at least still attempts to have that same chilling vibe. Bagul is completely ripped of all mystery this time around. While he was used sparingly in the first film, here he's featured constantly, and as the old rule of film monsters go, the more you show something, the less scary it becomes. The first film knew to keep the supernatural elements to a minimum and keep us in suspense, but Sinister 2 is bathed in fantasy and commits to showing us everything under bright spotlights. It goes against all the positive tropes the original had. The atmosphere, the dark style to the visuals, the creepy DIY realism to the tapes, the intelligent characters to latch onto, it's all nowhere to be found. There's one or two moments that might give you a chill, but on the whole, I really can't recommend it to anyone unless you're a diehard fan of the original. The reason being is Sinister 2 just isn't that original itself. Sinister as a series was actually meant to have a third film that crossed over with the Insidious franchise, wouldn't that be a crazy trip? I don't even know how they would manage to do it, but considering the lack of horror team-ups, Bagul versus the red-faced demon, I can get behind. Until then, Sinister 2 might have halted the franchise dead because it didn't make as much and got bashed relentlessly by fans and critics. Oh, what could have been.